have three outside.
Well, the official. Cupertino time. Three. All right, this is a hearing of the New Hampshire Ballot Law Commission. I'd ask the commissioners to identify themselves for the record, starting with Mr. Eaton.
Michael Eaton.
Sheila Frankel.
Brad Cook.
Deborah Hollingworth.
Dean Eckert.
And we are here today to consider a complaint filed by Libertarian Party candidate for, or would-be candidate to file for the special election in Grafton District 9. And apparently unable to change party registration to Libertarian to meet the criteria to qualify to fill out the Declaration of Candidacy, which says that you're a member, a registered member of a party in which you wish to run. And Mr. Stanlitz here, in the Secretary of State's office. And Mr. Buffetti is here, our counsel from the Attorney General's office. Is the complainant present?
Yes.
All right. If you would raise your right hand, you swear the testimony you're about to give before the commission will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you
God. I do.
Please be seated.
For the record, my name is John Babiars.
Welcome. Tell us what's going on.
Well, November 8, 2016, the Libertarian Party received 4% of the vote, which gave us to qualify the Libertarian Party as a political party in the eyes of the state. On Wednesday, May 17th, the Executive Council approved the special election for state representative for Grafton County District 9. Monday, May 22nd, to Friday, May 26, 2017, registration was open for signing up for candidacy. On Friday, May 22nd, at 9:30 a.m., I went to the town clerk to change from undeclared to Libertarian.
Excuse me, what town is?
This is the town of Grafton.
Town of
The town clerk stated it was not possible. And Friday, May 26th, at approximately 15:50, I arrived at the Secretary of State's office to sign up as state rep representative for the Libertarian primary. Reviewing the paperwork, which is essentially an affidavit, I could not sign it because even though I've been a lifelong party member of the Libertarian Party, in the eyes of the state and the state database, I was an undeclared, for the purposes of registration, undeclared voter. And so I could not sign that form, nor will did the Secretary of State Bill Gardner accept it because I was not a Libertarian in the eyes of the state. Since I wasn't going to perjure myself in signing that form, it was duly noted that I had the $2 in my possession to pay for the fee should I was allowed to, but that was not allowed to. And since it was the weekend, nothing more could happen. Monday was a holiday. Businesses were closed. Tuesday, at 14:30, on May 30th, we met here with Party Chair Darryl Perry, Secretary of State Deputy Dave Scanlon, and Karen Ladd. And we tried to sort things out. At that point, we requested a meeting with the Ballot Law Commission to try to sort things out. On Wednesday, May 31st, both myself and my wife is a registered Republican, we went to the town clerks to change our party registration to Libertarian. The town clerk still insisted she could not change it. Even after speaking with the Secretary of the State, Dave Scanlon, on that Friday, and Bill Gardner, she would not change it. I insisted that she call the supervisors of the checklist. The supervisor checklist was not aware of a special election. However, the supervisor told the town clerk to allow us to fill the registration forms, and the next time they meet, they would change the database or do the things necessary. So, further, this morning I was talking to one of the supervisor checklists, and they now told me that the change of party affiliation will be held until after the primary. So I ask you, in a normal sequence, in a normal year, there is a 1 week period prior to opening registration for running for office for the primary where people can change their ballots because the supervisor checklist meets. There is no provision here because it was basically 2 business days and the registration starts from when the executive council says we're going to have a special election to time the signing. And under the, I believe, your rules, you can't, supposedly, I can't change my party affiliation. I was undeclared. I've been a libertarian, but because through no fault of my own, I mean, you could say that I should have changed my registration during town meeting day. However, we all know town meeting day in most of New Hampshire is nonpartisan, so there's no point in changing at that point. And I don't know if I was even allowed to because there was a delay when we could change. I would think once the party achieved its 4%, sometime in November, I would be allowed to change my registration, but I don't think that was the case. So the problem I have here is, first of all, town clerks can either, they're not properly trained, but they can arbitrarily say no for me filling out a form. Where's my recourse to gain what was lost to me? I understand you're operating on a time window, just like the Secretary of State. Certain things have to happen at a certain time. But what happens when the bureaucracy violates my due process to have my chance to run at the ballot? Because it is a constitutional right that I can run for office. I have not committed any felonies under the any laws, but most importantly, under Article 11 of the Constitution, I've not committed any felonies within election laws, which would allow me to participate in the process. But what I see right now is every time I go do something to be part of the process, there's a roadblock, and I would like some of this alleviated. And that's all I'm asking for, a chance to be put on the ballot. The party wants me on the ballot. The party actually asked me to run for state rep. And so I was willing to do it, made the drive here to try to do it, and unfortunately, it didn't work out. And that's my testimony, and I'm sticking to it.
I'm sure it's true. A couple of questions, Mr. Debbie. Are you a registered voter in the town of Grafton?
Yes, I am.
When is the election scheduled?
The election is September 5th. The actual primary is in July.
Is there any other libertarian running in the primary?
No.
So there won't be a primary?
I think there's going to be a primary, just there won't be any name because...
No, I believe the statute, I'm not testifying, but I believe in a special election, the statute says unless there are two candidates running, there's no primary in that party. You'd only have a general election.
Oh, I thought once somebody signs up, it was open for write-ins also at that point.
Is that true? Okay. Just reading it the other night.
But the other factor, and we have to consider this, if we do a write-in to get my name on the ballot, it requires at least 35 people to vote for me. There's not even 35 registered libertarians in those three towns or four towns.
What other towns are in that district?
Bristol, Alexandria, Ashland, and Grafton. Is that correct?
That's not critical. Just trying to get a territorial feel for where you're going. So the elections, the general election's in September.
Yes.
And this is June, so we got plenty of time to... Just trying to figure out if we run into time constraints that would make it impossible to... Did you point out to the town clerk the provisions of RSA 654-34A that says a town or city shall permit changes in party affiliation to be registered with the town or city clerk?
Not on the Friday. And the reason I didn't is I would, hopefully they would know their job. She's been doing it for over 20 some odd years. But of course, she's well acquainted with the Secretary of State's office, since Grafton has the difficulty of having a clean election every time we have one. There's always calls to the Secretary of State's office because of some irregularity. So it's either a training issue or opposite issue, because my town clerk has the ability of quoting random RSAs that now have me scrambling the law books to try to figure out where did she come up with that. But okay, that's why I go to the Secretary of State's office. I figure I could get at least a more definitive answer.
Anybody else on the commission have any questions?
I have one. When the town clerk denied you the first time, did she give a reason?
She said she wasn't allowed to.
She said she was not allowed to.
Yes.
And she didn't elaborate on that statement?
No. Nope. I said, well, she said, if you don't want, she said, well, I said, I'm going to Concord anyhow because I'm going to sign up. She said, well, take it up with the Secretary of State. I mean, where's the recourse? Who sanctions these people? If they're not sanctioned, they're going to keep doing the same kind of stuff. I mean, I'm asking for relief. That's all I'm asking.
The recourse is here. You're there.
Yeah, I'm here. So.
That's why they told you to come see us. We have to figure this out. It's called passing the buck. Any other questions? Mr. Scanlon.
Well, aside from any conversations that Mr. Babier has had with local officials in the town of Grafton, there's no dispute about the facts that he has raised here. It is true that after the general election in 2016, the Libertarian Party organization qualified as an official party in New Hampshire, and so they're entitled to a primary ballot, and they're entitled to a column on the general election ballot. When that time comes. After the election was over, our office instructed supervisors of the checklist and clerks to start registering libertarians on the checklist in December. So after that point, anybody that wanted to be a libertarian could have gone to the town clerk's office or the supervisors of the checklist to register. The normal process is that in the first instance, any voter can go to a town clerk and fill out a voter registration form. The town clerk will accept all of that information, provide it to the supervisors of the checklist. That person is not entered onto the checklist, however, until the supervisors of the checklist vote to do that. So even though the town clerk can accept a registration, it's not official until the supervisors of the checklist take an action. In a regular state election, when there is a filing period for the state primary in September, the supervisors of the checklist are required to meet the day before the filing period opens so that anybody that wants to change the party affiliation has an opportunity to do that before the filing period opens so that they can run as a candidate in the party of their choice. In the case of a special election, the time frames are compressed to the point that the governing council will announce the date of the special election, and then the filing period begins the Monday after that Wednesday that action is taken and runs through Friday, 5 o'clock of the same week. There is no opportunity really for the supervisors at the checklist to hold a session. There's no mention of them doing that in the statute. Certainly, they wouldn't be able to meet the required advertising of a session, and it could be that the statute just haven't really thought about the fact that there might have been an additional party that obtained an official status since these laws were in place. Libertarians were a party in the mid-90s. There was an election where they didn't reach the threshold in terms of percentage of vote for governor or U.S. Senate, and so they dropped out of the official status. And now they're back.
Okay, but forget the, let's pretend he was a Democrat. Sorry. But let's pretend he was a Democrat. let's say he was undeclared and he wanted to run the Democratic Party for District 9. There's still no provision for this that would help him. I don't think
does this have anything to do with his being a Libertarian or a Republican, a Democrat? I mean, I don't think there's a, I looked in our favorite book here for a long time the other night, and there's no, as you say, there's no requirement that says when a special election is scheduled that the supervisors of the checklist will meet in order to allow this situation to be alleviated. It doesn't matter if you're a Libertarian or a Democrat or a Republican. There's no provision for that. If you're undeclared, you want to declare in a party.
That's true. I would agree with that.
Okay.
The options that are available to Mr. Babiar is if this request is not granted, is that he could go out and solicit 35 undeclared voters or new voters to show up at the Grafton polling place or any other town that is in that district to register as a Libertarian and then vote as a Libertarian, to win a write-in candidacy for state representative, you need 35 votes. The other option is that if there is still a vacancy in that office for that party after the primary is over, then the Libertarian Party can fill a vacancy by appointment for the general election.
Wouldn't another alternative be that the legislature is going to certainly have to address this in the future? But in the meantime, until they do, wouldn't a statement coming to the community or to the communities, towns, cities, that there is the power has been granted that they should allow them to register? And it, a legal counsel, our legal counsel, and we take a vote to say that that is the way that the law is interpreted. Is that a remedy?
I think that's something for the ballot commission to decide.
I'm just trying to get the time frames. The filing period is closed?
Yes. The filing period.
Nobody has filed as a Libertarian.
Nobody has filed as a Libertarian, that's correct.
The filing period is closed. One of the options you just mentioned was the Libertarian Party could designate him as the candidate for the election.
We still have the same problem that exists now.
He's not registered.
He's an undeclared voter, not a Libertarian on the checklist.
Does anybody know how often the supervisors of the checklist of the town of Grafton meet?
Mr. Babiar probably knows that better than I do. There are times of the year in the statute where they are required to meet. They can hold additional sessions as they see fit at their own discretion.
That was going to be my question. If assuming the town clerk accepted his filing, she still would have to go to the checklist supervisor. And you say they're not meeting, but you could call, they could meet and either approve or deny. Is that correct?
They would have to advertise a session for the correction of the checklist. Or depending on how they adjourn from their last session, they may be able to reconvene.
So there's no provisions for town clerks, supervisors of the checklist, or it seems like anybody else, to accommodate a special election.
So what they can do, they just
right.
Can't be, they're not forced to.
Right.
Now here's the question we're going to ask our lawyer, so I'm going to telegraph this to him even though I'm looking at you. Do we have the power to order them to meet, to accept his? So think about that, Mr. Buffet, for a while. Because if we had the power to order them to meet, and we said because of the, I'm not putting words in anybody's mouth, but if we said that the town clerk inappropriately didn't accept his file, and we told them, and therefore we allowed him to file. And if we told the supervisors of the checklist that they needed to meet and correct the record, and if we said you should take, that's all I have to say, if we said that you then had to take the filing late because
through no fault of his own, he was denied access to the process. The question is, do we have the power to do it? Because we're, and the reason I ask that question for everybody present is we're only a creature of statute as a commission. So we don't have power that the legislature didn't give us. So the question is, in that bundle of sticks that we have here in this book, does that power exist? And that's, I think, something we're struggling with.
Chairman?
Yes, sir.
If I may, I just have a follow-up question.
Sure.
I was trying to sort out. Did the clerk indicate that he or she would not take receipt of your declaration, or just that once you filed it, it would be inaccurate because there'd been no change in your status? What was, can you give me more detail?
Sure. The declaration was done at the Secretary of State's office. That was on that Friday. Okay, because that's the only place to do it. If we did it Monday, which is the only time she could do it in her office, then the rest of the other 4 days, it can only be done in Concord. All right. So, starting this process on the Friday, she just didn't want to do it.
Okay. So did you ask her, though, to submit your change of status to the supervisors? Did that occur?
She just told me to go to Concord and sort it out. In fact, when I went back Wednesday with my wife, she still was the same thing, and I was insistent on it, and that at that point, she actually called one of the supervisors, and he was most accommodating. But unfortunately, the window has passed.
When you say most accommodating, meaning he was willing to have a meeting and considered if she'd taken it, or what
he... I mean, he told me this morning he would, but basically he told her, take those forms, we'll make sure it gets into the database. But that was, again, after the fact. Had I known, you know, but again, for him, the people, to me, okay, it's been a couple weeks now since this happened, but for them to meet, so they have to warrant their session. Is it 72 hours in advance? Is that how it works, or?
If it's a regular session, I think they have to advertise 7 days in advance.
Okay. They can't comply with the law.
I guess what I'm struggling with in understanding that maybe it's a legal question is the first part of that application statute says the town or city shall permit changes to be registered with the clerk. So the part that I'm trying to get past is that statute doesn't, and maybe now I'm speaking, so it's not a question. So I guess I want to get clear on this. Did the clerk say, I won't take your change, or it just won't get processed in time? So
she said
don't bother.
She can't take it.
Look at Roman numeral 7 in that statute. Because you're right, it's exactly what it says. But then it says in 7, and then the ones aggregated by the clerk will be presented to the supervisor of the checklist, who will then change the checklist. So that's the first chapter of the story, and this is the...
I'm just trying to make sure you got through the gate with a registration.
Yes. We want to help you. We're just trying to figure it out.
And I
understand that.
Mr. Chairman, may I circle back to your
Certainly.
First question? Because
Certainly.
I was intrigued by that. And maybe this is for our Secretary of State. I was looking at 655.82 that talks about uncontested primaries, and I'm the new one to the table, so I may not understand this process, but it seems to suggest that you wouldn't be holding a primary if you had the following things occur. No party with more than one candidate filing, and then it says a no non-party or other candidate files a declaration of intent. So it was just unclear to me whether or not it was on these facts there was going to be a special primary election at all. I don't know. Is there going to be one?
We just had District 16's primary in Manchester. There was a Democratic primary because there were two candidates. There was no Republican primary because there was only one candidate, and there was no nothing. There was no chance to write in. There was nothing, if I understand it correctly.
And I voted in that primary because that's where I live, and there were ballots for all three parties.
Well, there were ballots for...
Yes. Now, in practice, you know, maybe this issue is putting focus on that statute. In practice, if both parties field only one candidate, then there is no primary that is held. The date of the primary becomes the actual election then for the candidates. There's simply a general election ballot printed, and that becomes the election.
Wow. I'm set to go with your question.
That's why I asked the question, because I read the same thing the other day, and I'm pretty sure that's what it said, but maybe I don't know. What's your thoughts, man?
I actually need a clarification on just not having a primary. So you're telling us that you print ballots, in this case, you would print ballots for all three parties. If there are only one Republican and one Democrat, then the town wouldn't advertise, or there wouldn't be any process for people to go and vote. How would they know that they would have that opportunity, that there's a ballot sitting there if they so choose to use it? I'm sure everyone here has always been under the impression if there was only one Republican and one Democrat, there was no primary. It went to the election.
I think we try to keep the special elections as similar to a regular election cycle as we can. So, when the primary ballots are printed, we know that there are races on the Republican ballot or the Democrat ballot where there are no candidates. But there is an opportunity for the voter to write in the name of someone that they would like to see hold in that position. Sometimes offices are unopposed. There's one candidate. And the voters still vote for those choices. In this instance, where you have at least one party that fields enough candidates to have a primary, the practice has been that the primary is then also held for the other parties, whether there's one candidate or no candidates. It gives the voters an opportunity to write someone in, which is the community's choice, as opposed to having, you know, a party leader in Concord, determine who that person is going to be that fills the vacancy.
That probably functioned quite well when we only had Republicans and Democrats running. Now we seem to have three parties that want to run.
Now, if you went to your town clerk tomorrow, forget everything you said. You went to your town clerk tomorrow and said, you got to take this change thing to submit to the supervisor the checklist the next time they meet. I'm just giving it to you now because I want to be a libertarian. And if your supervisor the checklist was cooperative and nice and said, let's have a meeting in a week and a half, and so they let you become a libertarian, you can become a libertarian. They do the administrative stuff that makes you a libertarian. And then your party committee could designate you as the candidate, and you could run in the general election.
Yes. However, I was informed that they received a letter that they can't change my party affiliation, even though they have the forms, until after the primary is over.
There is a restriction for voters who belong to a party from changing their party registration until after the primary election.
But that's changing from one party to another.
That's correct. If an undeclared voter can, I mean, they can...
But you can do it on the day of the primary, but you can't vote in that party.
That's right.
Is that done for you?
Well...
I don't know who's writing letters to whom, but that's what the law seems to say.
Yeah. Basically, the party is designating me as their candidate, but they have no official function at this point under the current law.
Well, they're not unless the supervisors at the checklist meet and put you on the checklist.
Yeah. I I didn't make the laws.
Okay, we didn't either.
Sorry about that.
We're all in the same, yeah, get him, wait. All right, we're going to talk to our council for a few minutes and see what we can come up with, so. Look up somewhere.
Do you want us to leave and then we can?
Yeah, you guys all go. Almost more of us than there are you.
Is this off the record?
Yes, turn off.
We were tempted to write an order that ordered the legislature to clean up the laws, but we decided that might be a little overbroad. Does anyone want to make a motion? Does anyone want to make a motion to the effect that we order that Mr. Babiarz's name be placed on the ballot for the primary in the Libertarian Party, and that order goes to the Secretary of State?
Mr. Chairman, you took the words out of my
mouth. And I will second that.
Is there any discussion? I would like to make a little discussion before we vote. We considered a whole bunch of things. We think that there's an omission in the statute, and the omission in the statute is requiring the supervisors of the checklist to meet within a certain period of time relative to a special election. That omission, which I think is an innocent omission, it just wasn't contemplated when they wrote the statute, that's just me talking, resulted in an untenable situation for both you and your party, although the party could designate a candidate at some point. We contemplated an order to the town clerk to do something and then the supervisors of the checklist to do something which would result in the Secretary of State having to do something. And we were wisely counseled that we could eliminate those first two steps. What this implies, and I think what the order will probably say, is that accompanying our order is an understanding that you will go to the town in its normal processes, file with the town clerk, which will be presented to the supervisors of the checklist in the ordinary course, so that your name will be entered in due course on the town records as a Libertarian. The effect of what we're saying here is that in signing the declaration, we're absolving you of perjury because we recognize that this is not going in the same order that it would have ordinarily gone. So we have a motion and a second. Mr. Eggert?
Aye.
Senator Hollingworth?
Aye.
Mr. Eaton?
Aye.
Mr.
Aye.
And the chairman votes aye. So, unanimous.
Chairman, do we need to advise the Secretary of State that they should notify the town clerk of the decision of the ballot law?
Yes. The Secretary of State should tell the town clerk, and there will be a written decision setting forth this decision. And. Any other business to come before the commission? Hearing none, we are adjourned.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.